Hello and welcome to SciJoy. In our last episode, we learned how encoders work, and in this one, we're going to learn how to build it. We 3D printed our encoders. If you don't have access to a 3D printer, you can cut yours out of cardboard. Our parts list, 3D printable files, pictures of the wiring, and code can be found on our Thingiverse, Hackster.io, and GitHub accounts. There's links to them in the description below. We connectorized our sensors, but you can use breadboards and jumper wires instead. We wired the brake beams, transmitter, and receiver, and we also powered and controlled our motor that is spinning the encoder. We used open beam for our structure. It's sturdy, adjustable, and we already had the parts laying around in our lab. This allowed us to move the sensors towards and away from each other. The sensors mounted and could be slid up and down the rail so we could line up the receiver and transmitter. The mounts were 3D printed, and we wanted to pack the sensors together in order to make the encoder as small as possible. Instead of using screws, we made bumps on the mount. We hot glued the sensors to the plate and screwed the plate to the rail. Connectors attached the sensors to the board. The ends of the wires were stripped, and then they were cut so all the wires going to each sensor were about the same length. The ends of the wires were trimmed in order to fit inside the crimp. Care should be taken when crimping to ensure a good electrical connection. You can pull on a crimp slightly to make sure that it's snug before you insert it into the connector housing, and a small pull can also be given once it's in the housing to make sure it's locked. You should be able to see the crimp engaged in the little cutouts. The other side of the connector is soldered to the prototyping board. The sensor side is plugged into the board side. The transmitter only has power and ground. The pin for the red wire of the sensor is wired to the power rail. The rail is wired then to the positive end of the battery terminal. The pin for the black wire goes to the ground rail, which is then wired to the negative side of the battery terminal. Just like the transmitter, the receiver has a red wire that goes to power and a black one that goes to ground. Additionally, it has a white wire that's used for signal, and we routed this to header pins. Instead of hooking up a terminal to the power and ground rails, we used headers. This way we could plug into the Arduino's power and ground. The motor is mounted to the structure with two brackets and is attached to the front bracket with two screws. We wanted to use a motor controller so we could adjust the speed. Two wires go to the motor and two go to the 9-volt battery. The switch allows us to change the direction of the motor. We can go clockwise or counterclockwise. And the knob allows us to adjust the speed. If you use smaller motors, just adjust the hole in the template that we give you and pay attention to the voltage requirements. We use Fusion 360 to draw the encoders and an OpenBeam Castle Pro to print them. You can manipulate these files and add more bits to the absolute encoder or more steps to the incremental or quadrature encoders. During this process, we had a few troubleshooting issues. The lower brake beam was always reading high. So we wired the sensors directly into the Arduino. This way we could eliminate the possibility that there was a short in the board that we soldered. Since it still was riding high, we used a multimeter and probed each of the sensors. The bottom one was always above 0 volts. So we knew we had a bad crimp and we just recrimped the wire. We also had to paint the wheels because the infrared signal was transmitting through the 3D printed material. Thank you for watching this episode of SciJoy. If you have any questions or comments, you can leave them down below. You can talk to us on any of the social media platforms. You can support us at patreon.com/SciJoy. And remember, keep exploring.